Nebraska, South Carolina, Texas. Wow, what a game.
There's a line shot in the right center field. It'll be in there. It could be extra bases. Nolan stands up at second with a double.
Hoisting that trophy, man, a night I'll never forget. Always an unreal feeling to win the national championship.
I too share a memory of going up against South Carolina. Everything on the line. Augie staring at me. Greatness. One pitch away.
Swinging a one-hopper down to Onaveras. That'll do it. The Texas Longhorns have won the 2002 College World Series Championship.
The greatest day of my life. Dogpiling with my teammates.
Today, nothing's changed. Gamecocks, Longhorns, two historic programs with untapped potential in front of them.
Can the new generation of Gamecocks and Longhorns return to Omaha soon? Let's get it on.
Welcome to Longhorn Network Baseball presented by Tiff's Treats. Good evening, everybody. A breezy night here in Central Texas. We've been waiting for this for a long time. It seems like we're in mid-June, but we're in mid-March. This is not a super regional. This is a regular season series between South Carolina and Texas. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to UFCU Dish Falkfield. Keith Long along with Greg Swindell. And when you look at these two guys on these two teams, both of them have been spectacular to start the year.
Oh, my. I mean, you said it right. This is what we've been waiting for on the schedule. South Carolina to come in here with Wes Clark, the big power hitter, 8 home runs on the season, going up against our guy Ty Madden, who's been nothing but phenomenal, exceptional, great, overpowering, whatever you want to use. These two guys tonight, a couple of titans went after it, mano a mano.
Well, you look at Ty Madden, last week's pitcher of the week in the nation. Two times Wes Clark has been the hitter, national hitter of the week throughout the nation. Both of them are just outstanding. It's going to be great to watch these two guys match up, no question. When you look at it, South Carolina comes in undefeated under the direction of Mark Kingston. Kingston in his fourth year as the head coach. 99 wins at South Carolina, looking for its 100th victory of the year. He will look at the lineup for South Carolina, and I'm telling you what, it's a good one from top to bottom, very good. But look at the slugging, the OPS number for Brady Allen in the leadoff spot.
Yeah, that's your leadoff guy right there. Over 1,000 for your leadoff guys, getting the job done. As he goes, the Gamecocks follow.
And you turn around, and they'll be facing Ty Madden. He's been spectacular. And we'll get to his numbers after we get the ball game started as Allen steps in. It's what we've been looking for. First pitch of the ball game, in there for a strike.
See Ty Madden, sophomore out of Cypress Cy Ranch High School, National Pitcher of the Week. We told you that one, that complete game shutout, 14 strikeouts in his last start. Just 3 hits in his last 2 starts and 26 strikeouts.
Pitch misses downstairs. And what are you looking for when you watch him come to the mound, Zeke?
Well, we talked about just 3 hits and 26 strikeouts. Keep on keeping on. He can touch 98 miles an hour and enjoy this moment. This is why the lights are on. You got a nationally ranked team in. Go after it tonight.
On the ground to Daly. And retired. Good start for Madden in Texas here. And again, this is a very good offensive lineup when from top to bottom for South Carolina. Come in undefeated on the season. Satterfield will step in. 6 foot, 195 grad transfer from Elon College. Transferred in from Greenville, South Carolina. Gamecocks third baseman. Fourth different SEC school Texas has faced this season. They are 0-3 against the SEC so far.
Well, those first three were kind of a blink. Having to not practice and not really be ready for it. I always say those three don't count. Now you can go after this South Carolina team. You learn from those games, don't get me wrong.
The 1-1 downstairs, and it's 2-1. I think you do learn from that. You got to give credit to Arkansas, Mississippi, and Ole Miss and Mississippi State are all still playing good ball. They're all ranked in the top five in America.
Top five in the nation.
2-1 pitch chopped on the ground. Zubia comes to get it quickly. He'll make the tag to get the out. Two quick outs for Madden here, both on the ground. He's been down. He's got great tilt, Zeke, and I want you to explain to the folks what I'm talking about. You and I know what it's about, but it's about how the ball is coming out of his hand toward the plate.
He's 6'4". He stays tall, uses his legs, gets good extension. And the biggest reason is we've talked to Sean Allen, is he's getting his hands out of the glove and everything's on time.
This is the matchup we've been looking for. Wes Clark, Forrest, Virginia, 6'2", 236 pounds, extremely strong, 8 homers on the season so far. Fastball, good location there. And the count even at 1-1. Look at those numbers. Wow.
Yeah, I say they're Inkavillion-type numbers. Pete Inkavillion had those type of numbers when he was in college, and if that's a comparison, you're doing pretty good.
Yeah, some of the best numbers we've ever seen. This ball hit hard down out to right. Huddle on his horse, able to run it down and make the play. Hit right on the button. Douglas Huddle able to run it down. We go to the bottom of the first. Texas coming to bat. Texas 130 victories in the 4+. He's in his fifth year. Texas lineup tonight looks a lot different without Austin Todd in it. That's why we've highlighted Douglas Hodo III, just because we're not going to see Austin Todd for a while with a separated shoulder. So you're taking a veteran out. A lot's going to fall on this young man's shoulders a little bit. Can he lead off and can he play that kind of defense? Just made a nice running catch there.
Oh, he's very fast in the outfield. Can he lay off pitches out of the zone? One thing he can do is get on base, and he's been doing a good job of that. The 409 average the last few games, going up against the redshirt junior, Thomas Farr, out of Tyrone, Georgia. See 2-0 on the season. One earned run allowed in all three starts this season.
Well, the thing that jumped off the page for me was the fact is that his walk to strikeout ratio is very good, and his hits and whip number is very good.
Yeah, he's a power pitcher. He'll go right after you. Good fastball. Might see it comparable to Ty Madden's early in this ball game. Got the juices flowing.
Doug steps in against Thomas Farr. Farr's first pitch, good fastball in there for a strike. You can see that one with some giddy up on it.
95, we talk about, got a power arm, fastball, curveball, changeup, and has started 6 games in college and hasn't been defeated. 5-0 in those 6 starts, and Doug Hodo greets him with a base hit to left.
Just found that 5-hole gap in between short and third, and a leadoff base runner.
Fastball came back over the middle of the plate, tailing. That's 10th straight game Doug Hodo has reached base.
That brings Eric Kennedy to the plate in his third season for the Longhorns in Tampa, Florida. And it's been a struggle for Eric. Really good offensive player. 213 as he steps in here. Throw over. Zeke, when you look at game plans and how teams want to play, Texas wants to run, especially these top three guys in this order. It'll be interesting to see how the Gamecocks try to battle against that and try to hold the running game in check.
That's what you do right there. You just saw it.
Excellent bunt and the speed of Kennedy just able to beat it out.
Joe Satterfield playing in, waiting for the bunt. It just perfect. Right down the line, slows down for Satterfield, goes down with the glove, has to transfer it, and by then Kennedy's going to be safe.
He makes the transition. Kennedy beats it out. Great start here for Texas. Back-to-back base hits. And that brings Mike Antico to the plate. Tico, the grad transfer, Colts Neck, New Jersey, and St. John's University. As he steps in, 208 on the year. Does he bunt here early in the game? First and second, put some pressure on the defense. South Carolina anticipating it. Swings away, fouls it back, and it's 0-1.
I think a lot of times you anticipate bunt. You're going to get a fastball, let him swing. See if Coach Pierce decides to lay one down right here.
Well, with Antico's speed, too, he gets it on the ground. There's a chance for him to get a knock.
Put pressure on the defense.
The 0-1 from far. Outside corner for a strike, and quickly it's 0-2. Antico tough to double up. They play him a little bit over into left center, deep in the outfield. This wind continues to blow from home plate to left field. Ball is carrying tonight. Fastball got him. Fooled him. Good location. Comes up with the strikeout.
There came with the fastball in. To Mike Antico. Looks like he just fooled him, kind of tailed back over the plate. See the fastball right there at the end. Has some tail to it. 94 miles an hour.
So one gone. Big strikeout for Farr. And that brings Zach Zubia, junior from Richmond, Texas. 6'4", 230 pounds. Off to a fantastic start. 359 as he steps in right now. Breaking ball. First one of the night in their first strike.
Good one. Really tight right there by Farr. Zubia saw 30 pitches in his 5 at-bats against Sam Houston on Tuesday. Really seeing the ball well this year.
He's got a lot of collegiate at-bats under his belt now. You can see his maturity as a hitter. No question, he gets time called here. South Carolina, double play depth in the infield. Zubia steps back in. Good breaking ball there. Did he go? Yes, he did. And quickly, it's 0-2.
Comes out of his hand like the fastball, and is that really late bite on it from Farr.
That's a great spin rate right there. Farr comes set again. The 0-2. Just outside. So 1-2 to Zubia.
Three straight breaking balls. Four, actually, to Zubia.
I would not change anything. See what they go to? Fastball away. And the count evens at 2-2.
That's a waste. Waste fastball right there, trying to trick Zach. I think you go back to the breaking ball if you're Thomas Farr.
Again, you heard me say I wouldn't have changed anything. I'd have thrown it 1-2 again. 2-2 now. As a hitter, you're not sure what's coming. As Zubia steps back in. Breaking ball misses outside, and the count goes full. You're putting them in motion here. I think you do.
I think you can with the speed of
both guys.
Kennedy and Hodo.
Big pitch early in this game here in the bottom of the first for Thomas Farr.
Second baseman Wimmer close to the bag at second. Doug can't get a too big of a jump if he's going.
Zubia steps back in. Long look in again. Far comes Set. Not running. On the ground. Having played to his left, can he get an out at second? Yes, he does. What an outstanding play.
Satterfield.
By Satterfield to get an out right there.
Down at third base, you'll see. He's going to dive for it. Saved a run by going to the turf right there. Gets it out of his glove in time to get Kennedy. No throw, and Mark Kingston's out of the dugout.
I think he's talking about, was there any kind of interference?
Yep.
Anywhere by the runner Otto coming down the line, or, and they're going to have a review to talk about this. And I don't think he's going to get any kind of call. We'll get a replay right here, Zeke.
Yeah, we'll take a look. See Douglas heading to third. Wasn't going on the play. I don't think there's anything wrong right there. I'm not sure what the discussion could have been about.
Well, Kennedy did slide in and come up, but there was no contact.
But wouldn't you go to the second base umpire for that?
Yeah, I'm not sure why you would go to the third base umpire. Silas Ardoin will step in. Runners at first and third here with two outs. It's far. An out away from getting out of this. Breaking ball, good one there for a strike. Back-to-back hits to start the inning. And then the strikeout and the fielder's choice. Well, you would hate to waste this if you're Texas.
Getting the breaking ball over early is key for pitching, especially in early in the game. That can set up later at bats. I know now you got runner in scoring position, so you don't want to throw a cookie in there. But that was a really good breaking ball for a strike to get ahead of Silas.
Ardoin steps back in. Fastball. Good combination outside corner, and quickly it's 0-2. Do you try to gamble a little bit here with some kind of first and third play with an 0-2 count? See what Texas does here. Far set. Fastball ripped down the left field line. Oh. Just foul.
We're talking about 5 inches right here. Perfect angle. We'll see this ball land just outside the line. Little turf pellets bounce back fair, but the ball's foul. And wow, that's close.
The 0-2 pitch. Tried to sneak a fastball by him. Ardoin was ready for it. So Silas back to the plate here.
I don't think he'll try to sneak another.
Outside. And it's 1-2. 17th pitch of the inning for Thomas Farr here. They have been stressful, but he's a pitch away from getting out of it. Comes Set. Got him. Two strikeouts and a ground out after Texas puts a couple on. Comes up empty. We go to the second. Nothing, nothing. The Gamecocks of South Carolina, back-to-back national champions in 2010 and 2011.
Pretty good teams right there.
Pretty really good baseball teams.
But to win one is tough. To go back-to-back is really impressive, and that's notable MLB alum.
You're right. Mookie Wilson, I got the opportunity to play against. Called Jackie Bradley in a super regional when he was at South Carolina. Tyler Webb, we might have an opportunity to talk to him over the weekend. Hope we can. Texas threatened but came up empty in the bottom of the first. 4-5-6 due for South Carolina. Seiler steps in.
Big man right there.
6'5", 232 pounds. Looks like a power forward.
Chokes way up on that bat.
Gaston, South Carolina.
Trying to use everything he can against Ty Madden.
Just misses inside on a cutter.
Yeah, it looked like it was, huh?
Like it came out of his hands. Ninth ball game. Eighth start. In the fourth spot in left field tonight. 1-1 inside, and that's two in a row that Ardoin hadn't been able to glove.
Yeah, it's a breaking ball. First one you can see because it has late cut, got by him. That one didn't, just kind of rolled in there. Now you got to go after him. Got to challenge him right here.
Madden's 2-1 delivery. Inside corner for a strike. And it's 2-2. A little bit of a delay right there as a call. Wasn't sure we were going to see that right arm. 2-2 inside, and the count goes full.
Five pitches all in to Seiler.
Every start, Zeke, you started an awful lot of games, not only in college but in professional ball. Every start's different. We'll get to it here. 3-2 foul back. And the reason I say that is, you know, because your warm-up's a little different. It's a different day. You expect your stuff to be there. But each time you have to adjust, don't you?
Oh, yeah. You know what you have coming out of that bullpen. Okay, my curveball wasn't very good in the bullpen. Let's try the slider today. Changeup wasn't very good. Let's try the curveball. You're always going to have that one right there if you can get it over. The fastball, yeah. You have to adjust on the fly sometimes. But you know what you have when that gate opens and you step on the mound. But you still have to throw it.
Yeah,
you have to continue because you might get the feel and it might come back.
I, as an ex-catcher, I used to have to say, hey, we still got to use that pitch. We can't – it's not very good today. I don't care if it's not very good. We still got to use it.
We got to show it.
We absolutely do. Eister steps in. Andrew, senior, Ocala, Florida. 341 on the year. He's hit three homers. He's driven in 15. That's second on the club. That OPS, 1147. It's been doing some damage.
A few 1 point something.
Yeah, that's doing some damage.
In that lineup.
Texas looking for the double play ball in the infield, straight away and very deep, especially in left. Wind blowing briskly from right field corner to the left field corner. Nothing fancy about that. See if you can catch up. Couldn't. See that breeze. Going to be a factor.
That's what sometimes is confusing when you have the type of fastball that Ty Madden has. For the first few innings, I would throw it 99% of the time until the team you're playing makes an adjustment on the fastball. Keep using it. First strikeout for Ty Madden.
Well, they went away from it here.
Yeah, well, I mean, with two strikes, that's that slider that's been really good for Ty Madden this year. It's not a lot of depth to it, but it's late and sharp.
Mendham steps in, David. First baseman. 293 on the year. Young man from Ontario, Canada. Strong left-handed hitter. Homered. He's driven in 9. Just misses inside. Telling you, watching these guys take BP, first time we've gotten the opportunity to see South Carolina, they are physical.
If looks or anything, they have you want beat already when they get off the bus. They're big.
Great hack, fouls it straight back. And it's 1-1. Madden set. Great location there. And ahead now, 1-2.
There's a lot of things you work on in the fall and in the summer. We've heard Ty Madden talk about he pitched probably 60 or 70 innings over the summer when there wasn't baseball, but you go out and have simulated games where you pretend runners are on and still have to pitch innings. That's when you learn, that's when everything starts to come together as far as getting the ball out of the glove on time. Finding that, throwing a 3-1 slider for a strike or 2-0 breaking ball for a strike. Then when you get out on the mound, that's when it becomes second. Man, you just feel good with it.
It's repetition. It allows you under pressure to repeat.
Yep.
The 2-2 throw over. Awful lot of pitches here early in the season, though, for Madden, with two complete games back-to-back. That third start, or that third time out after that, it always is one of those things where you go, wow. It is early, but you are now in mid-March. So,
well, there's
been throwing for about 7 or 8 weeks now.
There's head coaches, pitching coaches know when you have that one. Right? Ty Madden is that one, meaning he's going to give you 100 pitches at least a start, whether it's 6 innings, 7 innings.
And you hope it's longer than that.
Right.
Well, first time we find out if Mark Kingston will put anybody in motion. This is an opportunity here. Do you run? Full count here.
Sailor hasn't had much of a lead over there.
Not running. Upstairs, second walk of the inning. A little bit out of sorts is Ty Madden.
Second walk, both to the lefties that are in the lineup for South Carolina.
Colin Burgess will step in. See the pitch count up to 28. That ball strike ratio not good at this point. Burgess 269 on the year. He's homered, he's driven in 5. Lexington, Kentucky, sophomore. Upstairs, and it's 1-0.
Watch out.
Throw back to second base. That's why you're backing up all time. Young infielders, don't put your head down. All the pitch was a ball, and just put your head down. As anything can happen, you got to watch what's going on the field.
As Mitchell Daly has his back turned head down, that ball's into center field, yeah, possibly a run.
That's exactly right. 1-0 in there for a strike, and it's 1-1. This is when you get tested in your mound presence. You've been really going along real well, Greg. So all of a sudden, I don't think Ty's had 2 walks in an inning this season.
Only had 6 all year coming into tonight.
Did not offer, and it's 2-1 to Burgess. Got to make it happen here. If you're Burgess, you're looking for something you can drive. Upstairs, and it's 3-1.
You're just out of sorts.
Yeah, it's a good time. Sean Allen making his way to the mound to talk to his veteran right-hander.
He's in different territory right now. Hasn't walked many, especially 2 in an inning all season. You have to continue to trust your stuff. A lot of fastballs up in the zone. Could be just one little thing, getting that hand out a little quicker, out of the glove.
And a lot of that has to do with mechanics. That's what they're talking about, just getting that separation where you're not falling or, you know, arm can't catch up.
Well, you've given up 3 hits all year. You haven't thrown from the stretch too much.
That's true. That is a good point. 3-1 delivery. Had a good swing. Fouled it back. The count goes full. One thing about pitching, You can make one good pitch right here, get a ground ball, and you can get in the dugout.
We saw Tanner Witt Tuesday night do that with the bases loaded to an All-American at the plate.
The payoff, there goes the runners. Downstairs, ball four, and Ty Madden has walked the bases loaded here. So one gone in the inning. Braden Wimmer will step in, second baseman. On the season, hitting .382. He's been a really good start. He's homered four times. He's driven in seven.
Throw a good slider right here, get that double play, and be out of the inning.
Safety squeeze up the first baseline. Do you let it roll? Madden lets it roll and gets it in foul territory. It just rolls foul. That's a really nice job right there. Might not have gotten out anyway.
He was late getting over there. Not expecting it one. I mean, I don't know if anybody was expecting a bases loaded squeeze bunt right here, but it was perfect right down the line. And Ty was not going to be able to get anyone. Might as well let it roll, and it does go just foul.
And all you have to do, Greg, as soon as it gets outside, is touch it. You don't have to secure it or anything. Just touch it in foul territory, and it's a foul ball, and he did that. So 0-1. Wimmer steps back in. Swings and misses. Quickly, it's 0-2. High pitch count already for Madden. This will be his 37th of the ball game coming. Out to right. This will get the job done. Tagging. On his way to the plate, sacrifice fly. South Carolina on the board. They lead 1-0. Nice piece of hitting right there.
0-2 count. Got it up. Wimmer does a good job of getting it up in the air far enough to advance two runners. Ty Madden still one out away from getting out of the inning.
George Khalil will step in, shortstop. 179 on the year. Can absolutely pick it. Outstanding defensively with an opportunity right here. Young man from Melbourne, Australia. Played up the road here in the state of Texas, though, for Clemson Junior College.
Down there in Waco. Up there in Waco.
South Carolina gets on the board without the benefit of the base hit. Still has an opportunity here. Upstairs again. You mentioned it. His misses have been above the belt.
Talk about making an adjustment with that. You start throwing your breaking ball more. I mean, right here to Khalil, who's not a big average guy, just at 179.
Chopped on the ground. Picked by Williams to second, to Daly, and gets out of the inning. But not before South Carolina gets on the board, takes a 1-0 lead.
Longhorn Network Baseball is presented by Tiff's Treats. Tiff's Treats cookie delivery, baked to order, delivered warm. And in part by Coors Light, official sponsor of the Texas Longhorns.
The tower on campus at the University of Texas on a gorgeous night. It's been overcast all day. It is breezy, blowing out to the left. Capacity crowd for what we can have in UFCU Dish Falk Field. This is by far the biggest crowd of the year. South Carolina, the Gamecocks on the board. They came up with one run without the benefit of a base hit at the top of the second. So Thomas Farr out for his second inning of work, and he'll be facing the 6, 7, and 8 spots in the order here on Friday night of this three-game set that gives me the feeling, I know it's March 12th, but it very easily could be June 12th and we could be in a super regional with these two teams.
Some nationally ranked teams here, Texas and South Carolina. And this bigger crowd that have been here all year. It's a nice thing to see. Come out and watch some good baseball.
Faltini will step in. Redshirt freshman, and of course, with the COVID, everybody gets the extra eligibility. So he's in his second year here on campus at the University of Texas. I would say over the last 6 or 8 ball games has become more and more comfortable at the plate. Freshman from Richmond, down in the Houston area. Good change up there for a strike.
It dropped down a little bit on that one. Little different arm angle.
Breaking ball upstairs, didn't get on top of it.
A lot of times you throw 2 off-speed pitches in a row. I mean, you already have the hitter slowed down. Now you're doing a favor by throwing a second breaking ball, but hung it over his head and then threw a fastball by him.
With some giddy up on it. So quickly, 2-2. Right side out of play. Greg, when we had the opportunity to play here at the University of Texas, both of us played here. When I played here, we had very, very few major teams coming in and out, which you have more of these type of series. We'll get to it after this 2-2 pitch. Hit pretty well into left center. Wynn's got a piece of this. It's off of the wall. It's going to be a stand-up leadoff double for Faltini.
Good at bat by Trey. Takes the change up. Takes the breaking ball. Gets this one right over the inner half. Reached base in 7 straight games now. 4th double.
Good start here for Texas in the bottom of the second. But getting back to the point we were making, we didn't have, Dave Winfield and Paul Molitor from Minnesota came in and beat us up pretty good when I was here. But we didn't have really big matchups very often with other schools. But by the time you got to college, a little bit a while between when I left, you get there, y'all had a lot of series where you had big matchups with teams coming in from across the country.
We had Cal State Fullerton come in and Augie Garrido. We had Arizona State would come in. I know Paul Molitor. I'm going to let him know that you still say that they weren't much.
Oh, they were. They came in here for a little Tuesday, Wednesday, walked out of here 2-0.
Minnesota came down when I was here.
Melendez steps in. His job. Ball gets away from Burgess. Back to the screen. Great opportunity here. See how they call that. It was a wild pitch. So opportunity for Texas to take advantage here.
Far hasn't had this great command in this ball game. Had enough in the first inning to get out of it. So far this inning just hasn't been able to hit a spot.
The 2-0 way upstairs, and it's 3-0. But I think you come to one of these schools to play baseball, to play in series.
Oh,
like
yeah.
This.
I mean, this is what you want. I mean, now you don't play too many series before conference starts.
3-0 downstairs and a 4-pitch walk. First walk issued by Thomas Farr.
I haven't seen Thomas Farr throw much at all, but he just doesn't seem right now.
You can see the comparisons of these two programs.
But those programs look right there.
Yeah.
Back-to-back for South Carolina. Texas was 6.
Well, 2 of those 6 were against South Carolina in the finals.
They were there in 85, I believe. We're in Omaha. They were in there, I believe, 81 and 82. They made it to Omaha. So 11 trips. They've had a Golden Spike Award winner.
You know who the coach of South Carolina was in 1975?
something Richardson?
Bobby Richardson.
Yes. That's
Yankee fan growing up. Huh?
And you say that these resemble the Yankee uniforms, these grays.
Oh, they do.
A little bit.
They're road uniform here for South Carolina. Obviously, they're the Gamecocks, in it, but it's got that Yankee look a little bit. Conversation over as Cam Williams comes to the plate. Williams, 3-for-4 with runners on third and less than two outs, and that's what you need. You need to produce in this opportunity.
Right now, a hit's the best thing that can happen. You want to put the ball in play right now and get a run across after you failed to do that in the first.
Popped up. Wynn will push it into the stands.
Can't continue to give the opposition time. If you can't score early, let Thomas Farr settle in sometimes isn't a good thing.
Yeah.
And they got some more arms coming out of that bullpen.
Well, sometimes you let guys get off the hook that have a little trouble, they'll find it, and then you got troubles. Inside corner, great location with that fastball, and quickly it's 0-2 to Cam Williams.
That gives a deception that it wasn't a strike, but catcher there was set up out, and it was on the inner half of the plate. He had to reach back over the plate to catch.
The 0-2. Just threw it by. Reach back, let it go. Third strikeout for Thomas Farr, and a big one.
Yeah, after the visit. Three fastballs, that one. Call that one Powder River's all up and in. Here it is, see if you can hit it.
Couldn't catch up to it, couldn't get on top of it. Mitchell Daly, true freshman from Madison, Alabama, will step in. 6'1", 185. Making his ninth appearance, his seventh start.
Well, he saw South Carolina with a bases loaded squeeze attempt. I wonder if Texas could be thinking that right here.
It's not a bad play. He does square, pulls the bat back, pitches in for a strike. You know, it's really not a suicide squeeze, Greg. It's safety squeeze, and if you're a runner at third, you have to make sure the ball's on the ground before you break.
And it has to be a good bunt because you don't have to go.
There's
no way you have to go in this situation.
You can read the third baseman. You just go right along with him. Daly squares again. Breaking ball, pulls the bat back, and the count evens at 1-1.
Then you have the opportunity also to pull it back and chop it in the ground.
If you can get those guys moving around, they absolutely.
First baseman right there was way in. Khalil was standing on second. They kind of had the wheel play going. The middle of the field, position-wise, was wide open.
Daly steps back in. Far set, he does square early, now asks for time. A little cat and mouse game going on here. David Pierce coaching in the third base box, goes through the signals. Philip Miller in the box over at first for the Longhorns. And Daly steps back in. Gamecocks at double play depth in the middle of the infield. Throw over, snap throw. Melendez back in safely. A lot of signs, a lot of activity. Pace of play is really slowed down when you got runners on here.
Neither of these pitchers give up many runs.
Bunted up the first place line, foul. So it'll be 1-2.
I think that's why you go back and think in the first inning, why are you trying to bunt a run in with the bases loaded? Well, Ty Madden doesn't give up many. You try to get them any way you can. Texas thinking right along with them right here.
Well, Thomas Farr's been really good. Got a 1.56 ERA and 2-0 coming into the game. So now you got to make contact if you're Daly here. Righty-righty matchup with a 1-2 count. Breaking ball, did he go? He did not. And the count evens at 2-2. Boy, that was a good location with that breaking ball.
That was one of the better ones he's thrown this inning. Again, as far as the spin goes in late break. Thirty-fifth pitch of the night coming for Farr.
Yeah, both of these guys, it's been a labor of love so far. Both of them have thrown a lot of pitches. 2-2, didn't get the call on the outer half, and the count goes full.
Ooh, that was close.
Tough pitch to take. Now is Melendez off with the pitch here. A lot of things can happen.
I think you got to right here. And if you're out in no man's land, stop and try to get Trey home on a throw.
Far set. Melendez is going. Pitch back through the box, up the middle. Melendez on his way to third, first and third, one across. We've got a tie game.
Mitchell Daly not getting the bunt down, but works the count. That fastball out over the outer half does a good job making contact, putting it in play, and when you do that, good things can happen for Mitchell Daly. Gets the base hit. Ivan Melendez will go off when he is off of the pitch, will go first to third. Big at bat right there by the freshman.
Absolutely. Tied this game up. Back to the top of the order. You're in the same scenario with great speed at the plate. And a guy that does bunt on a regular basis. Because you could be in that same scenario right here. Far set, checks the runners. There goes Daly's. Little hit and run.
And he hung a breaking ball. Had a pitch to hit up in the zone. But doing what you have to do on a hit and run is swing the bat and fouled it off.
David Pierce trying to get some action going.
Well, this team has speed. The Texas team, they've started to use it the last week or so in different ways.
Throw over. Back in safely. Daly's base hit, the fourth of the ball game for Texas. Breaking ball, misses outside. Count evens at 1-1.
Took the hit and run off, he put it back on.
I like the safety squeeze here with the speed. For me, just, I think if he gets it down, you could get a run and get a base hit out of it. See what happens. Swinging, fouled it back. Now all of that by the wayside now. 40th pitch of the game coming for Farr. Boy, he needs a strikeout.
They got a big one with Williams with runners on first and third. First and second, actually. Now, looking for another one with Hoda.
Right side, playable. I don't know if this is deep enough. Could be a play at the plate. Tagging up is Melendez. Here comes the throw to the plate. It is in time for the put out, and that retires the side. Really nice throw by Eisler in right field. This is a perfect throw at the plate.
Yeah, it's not deep, but David Pierce taking a chance, but Eisler comes up and puts it right on the money. Not even close.
We go to the top of the third inning in a 1-1 ball game as both these teams find a way to get on the board. We want to take this opportunity, though, to bring in Kylie McDaniel And he's welcoming in. He's a baseball insider for ESPN, and he specializes in the draft. He's obviously been the director of baseball operations for the Atlanta Braves before he came in. Now, Kylie, you've gotten the opportunity to first pitch, though. This is lined to right. Great play by Eric Kennedy for the first out of the inning. But your job at this time of year gets exciting because you get an opportunity to see these guys that are draft eligible.
Yeah, I was at a game today in Greenville, South Carolina, seeing a Michigan lefty, Steven Hajar. And that's sort of like my aim for the last couple of months has been, you know, I'm based in Atlanta, so there's a lot of players around here, but specifically the northern schools, when they come down, you want to get them out of the way because I'm, you know, probably not getting on a plane to fly to Michigan to see prospects.
Man,
but a lot of them will come down here and, you know, doing various rankings and things like that, trying to scoop up everybody I can. But yeah, we're about to get to conference play and have to get all these, you know, SEC, ACC arms that are in my general area. And I was just mentioning before the break, you know, Ty Madden pretty high on my list of guys to track down. May not be able to do that one in person, but this is the next best thing.
Well, good. Yeah, Ty Madden, we are lucky to have the opportunity to watch him pitch often. Anyone else on this Texas ball club in your rankings? I know Hanson might be up there. Eric Kennedy's also one, I think, that's on the list somewhere.
Yeah, there's a number of guys of interest. The issue with a lot of these guys that aren't in like the first couple of rounds, and that goes for South Carolina, a lot of these big schools, Thomas Farr is one of them, where he's on the radar. He was a guy at a junior college a couple years ago and just hasn't had a chance to really perform that much. So he's like on the radar as like, oh, if he performs well as a starter, then, you know, he's a top five round prospect. And right now, if he's, you know, not commanding it well and looks more like, you know, reliever in pro ball, which is kind of the rap on him coming out of junior college, then he's, you know, somewhat further down. So, you know, we're getting to the point where I think you can judge a little bit by performance, and West Clarke of South Carolina is a good example of that, where he's at the, you know, the forefront of a lot of discussions of guys that weren't really on the radar that through the first month have, you know, really asserted themselves. And we're about to get into, you know, sort of the conference play, the competition where you can really take something from the performance.
Well, Kylie, it's a strikeout right there. Madden looks a lot like him. He's seen for the last couple of times out. But my question is, with not having but a five-round draft last year, has that affected not only your job, but the way we need to look at the draft coming into here in 2021?
Yeah, I mean, the main byproduct of that is that there's just more guys around. Like, you know, at Florida, they have Tommy Mace, who probably would have gone in the second round, you know, all things considered, and also Jack Leftwich. And a lot of these schools, like Texas and South Carolina, have guys that would have gone for 6th to 8th round kind of bonuses, maybe in the 15th or 20th round. Some high school kids that maybe would have signed out of high school are now on campus. Like, there's just a lot more guys around, and a lot more traditionally, like 21-year-olds. You know, if you're in the top 5 rounds as a 21-year-old, you sign and you go pro. There's a lot of 22-year-olds that, you know, have some track record in these major conferences. You have to then sort of learn how to, as a scout, value those guys, because typically the 22-year-olds are the seniors that are sort of passed over, that you sign for $10,000, that are, you know, sort of afterthoughts. You just kind of move them around to save money to spend in other parts of the draft. And, you know, now some of these guys are, you know, first couple round type guys.
Well, Ty Madden is facing Wes Clarke right now. These two, just looking at them, this is what the matchup we've been looking forward to for all weekend. Talk to us about these two in a matchup.
Well, yeah, Madden's general approach is that four-seam fastball up in the zone and the slider either down or in the fringes to either side of the zone. And Clarke is a huge 70 or 80 power on the 20 scouting scale. You can kind of hear it there.
And this ball's on the ground to second. Kylie, can you stay with us for another half inning? That went pretty quickly.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, well, we're going to pitch it to the break. When we come back, we'll visit more with Kylie McDaniel. 1-1 ball game. We go to the bottom of the third. Welcome back to UFCU Dish Fog Field. 1-1 ball games. We go to the home half of the third. Keith Moreland, Greg Swindell, and Kylie McDaniel is still visiting with us. We're glad he is. Now, we've got up on the board, you may not be able to see it, but we've got your 2 through 18, and Jordan Hicks is the left-hander in the draft. But, boy, you got those two guys from Vanderbilt right at the top.
Yeah, I got to see them, I think it was 2 weeks ago. They were pitching on both ends of a doubleheader on a Sunday, and they're both up to 98 with a plus breaking ball, a track record going back to high school of being sort of first-round type prospects. Vanderbilt's a bit of a pitching factory, I'd say them, and Florida maybe the two best schools in the country in terms of just every year seemingly having a first-round talent. And, I mean, I don't think they can really move below, like, 7th or 8th, depending on how their spring goes.
Give us a scouting report on that lefty from Kansas State. He looks pretty special, Wicks.
Yeah, big guy up to 95, really good changeup, like almost top of the scale changeup. The breaking ball for pro scouts is like a little below average, not quite as consistent as you want. It's probably somewhere in the middle of the first round right now, but I think there'll be some slightly different accounts of him from scouts depending on how the spring goes and how that breaking ball comes along, how he does against the better competition. But I would say his range is anywhere from, you know, 12 to 25, something like that.
1-1 pitch swung through by Kennedy. Now the next thing, we've been talking a lot about pitching. Who are some of the better hitters that you've seen that are going to be coming out and draft eligible this year?
Yeah, that's the big challenge, because with pitching, you know, a guy can throw 90 and then suddenly throw 98 and move him up the board because it's very evident that he got better. Whereas with hitting, you're reacting to the pitcher. You need months and months, and in most cases, years and years of history of hitting those guys. And so having very few games played the last 2 years, a lot of these guys don't have the track record. So the guys that got a lot better last year, we probably don't know it yet. We'll find out in the next month or two. But right now, Matt McClain, shortstop at UCLA, he was an unsigned first rounder out of high school at the Diamondbacks. He'd probably go, you know, 5-6, something like that, if the draft were today. And then it's sort of a big question mark. Arguably the second best college hitter right now is a 5'9 center fielder at Boston College named Sal Frelick that I saw last week. And another guy on that list, Richard Fitz. Frelick took Fitz deep twice at Auburn last weekend, and has really worked his way into a nice spot in the first round.
And Kennedy comes up, takes the fastball as far. That two-seamer again, running it back over that inside corner.
Yeah, it is. Starts out at the front knee of Kennedy and runs it right on the inner half, freezes him for the called strike.
Golly, the next one I have for you, and we talked about hitters, we talked about the guys, is who are some of the guys that you have on your list within inside the Big 12 conference, since we'll see an awful lot of them here on LHN?
Yeah, I would say Wicks and Madden are the two main guys. They were sort of identified a little earlier in the process and, you know, have a chance to really move up. I don't think there is a guy kind of right behind them in that, like, sort of later first round, top of the second round area. I think there's a sort of number of guys in range that could work their way in there. But like I said, especially with the hitters, there's just not a lot of bulk to go off of. So guys like Wes Clark can kind of look the part and perform for a month. You want to see a little bit more.
Yeah, because hitting, it you can't make that decision right off the bat, and quickly the crowd on home plate umpires, it's 0-2. And Tico, who pulls this ball foul, remains 0-2. The last thing we have for you, thanks for spending the time to do this for me, would be evaluation. Now, you've identified some of these guys that you're going to look at. Now, is it identify and follow? Is that the main thing that professional baseball will be doing for the rest of this spring?
Yeah, that's the idea. You've got your list of guys that are of interest in the top, you know, 5, 6, 7 rounds, and now you try to really dive in. And a lot of the college players, one of the big factors now is there's like, I think, 80 college programs that have TrackMan devices. And so you don't have to have a scout in the stadium to tell slider looks a little bit different, spin rate on the fastball is the reason he's getting more swings and misses. There's some things that can help you identify guys for games you didn't have a scout at schools you don't normally scout as much. Those sorts of things will help out, but right now, and obviously there's like sort of limited travel, a lot of teams only have a handful of guys allowed to get on flights, so it's more sort of regionally based. So your area scout is worth his weight in gold this year if you can really stay on top of these guys.
Kylie McDaniel, thank you for taking the time. A full inning, I know you've got your wife and family and you're right there, so let you go back and enjoy your Friday evening, but thanks for taking the time to visit with us.
Yep, thanks for having me.
Take care. As Zubias is 0-2, it's always interesting to hear how things are evaluated. You know, you and I got the opportunity, the good Lord bless us, to play in the big leagues, and it's a hard thing to do, but all these guys have aspirations of playing professional baseball.
Oh, yeah, and Kylie's one of the best in the business of following them and learning talent. Does a good job, and Thomas Farr does a perfect job that inning. As the horns go down, 3 strikeouts, we got a tie game heading to the fourth.
The series continues tomorrow and Sunday against the South Carolina Gamecocks. Tomorrow, coverage starts at 2:30. That's moved up. If you're looking at a schedule, because of weather, game's been moved up to 2:30 and then 11 Central on Sunday. We do have a time change Sunday night, so that's going to be early. you know, because the clock goes forward. Daylight savings. You can also find it right here on LHN and the ESPN app. So it's going to be an exciting weekend. We're through a third of this game, and it's 1-0. Ty Madden has not allowed a hit, but he did walk three batters in the second inning in a sacrifice fly. South Carolina got on the board. So 4-5-6 due here against Madden. In the fourth, quickly on the ground, Zubia. And a lot of quick outs here, Greg, since those three walks for Madden.
They had unusual loss of command in that three-walk inning. Fortunately, just got out of it with just one run. Finding it right now. Got a Wes Clark to ground out the end last inning on a 3-0 pitch. That's always a blessing for a pitcher right there.
Wessler steps in. Right fielder. Strikeout victim his first time up. First pitch in there for a strike. Well, all of a sudden, that tilt back and good location back.
Yeah, it's just having a conversation with Sean Allen on the bench in between innings. Kind of having a conversation with yourself in between innings. A lot of things can factor into it.
And the 0-2 fouled off right side. We'll do it again. Okay. One run on no hits, no errors for South Carolina. 1-4-0 for Texas.
Can't get in too quick of a rhythm, though, where in counts such as 0-2, you throw one right in there.
Upstairs, got away with it. And it's 1-2. The 1-2 again, off of Madden, into the outfield for a base hit, first of the night for South Carolina.
Breaking ball by Ty. Looks like it surprised him coming back to him. You saw him try to flinch a little bit there, got him off the front shin. Caroms off and gets away from Daly for the base hit.
Pretty good job of hitting right there. I mean, it wasn't a great pitch, but I'd stand with it, taking it back through the box on a breaking ball. Mendham will step in. He walked the second of the three walks in the second. Ardwin does a nice job. You don't anticipate that ball down there. Out of the stretch, this is where Madden has seemed to have some struggles in this ballgame.
Yeah, just you can. You're worried about the runner. You haven't done it a lot this year. You're already in your own head because you did walk the three. So you have to continue. This is where.
There goes the runner.
Preparation.
Pitches a strike. Throw to second. Is in time by Silas Ardwin. Was there hit and run miss there?
Something. That ball's right down the middle. And Eister got thrown out by 10 feet. Perfect throw, good release there by Ardwin. Faltini just waiting, just a header right there. Gets him on the shoulder right before the hand. The turf didn't give too much. A perfect throw by Silas Ardwin and a good tag down in second.
Foul back, quickly it's 1-2. Fifty-ninth pitch of the ball game coming from Madden here with a 1-2 count. Spiked it.
He's beating himself up out there. It's unusual to see wildness.
He just doesn't have his normal rhythm tonight.
But he's given up one hit and one run. Three and two-thirds.
You got to find a win. I've heard you say it many times. You got to find a win when you don't have your best of stuff. You just have to. 2-2. Inside corner for the strikeout. third of the ball game for Madden.
Found that one right there, Zalt. Arduan throws the runner out at second. Madden gets the K to end the inning.
Thomas Farr, the redshirt junior out of Tyrone, Georgia, got himself in a little trouble in the first, but got out of it with a couple of strikeouts. Trouble in the second, leadoff double to Faltini. He came around to score the only run for Texas, but in the third, he found it, striking out Kennedy, Antico, and Zubia for that third inning. See the comparison, Thomas Farr, three innings, four hits, one run, one walk, six strikeouts in the three innings, Ty Madden. Four innings, unusual three walks for Madden and three strikeouts. 53 pitches for Farr, 60 for Ty Madden.
But a tie ball game at 1-1. As we go to the home half of the fourth, Arduan will step in. First pitch from Farr in there for a strike. You can almost feel both these guys starting to get a feel for it here. Good breaking ball there. You mentioned it earlier in the broadcast, Zeke, when you talked about it. You know, sometimes you got to get guys early because if you don't, it's over.
Well, they can settle in. Yeah, they always said the Hall of Famers, if you got them early, you could beat them occasionally, but once they settled in, they were lights out. Thomas Farr, 14 batters faced on 12 first pitch strikes. He's been getting ahead in this ballgame.
The 1-2 to Arduan misses outside. Yeah, he's been getting ahead, but he's been picking a little bit. And what I mean by that is he's gotten to 1-2, and then he's missed a couple times. He's had a lot of three-ball counts.
Yeah, because he goes out of the zone too far. You got to throw pitches that are close to the plate, the ones that gets him in trouble, and then he just comes back with his fourth straight strikeout. That one, like Kennedy last inning, a fastball. Outer half that comes back over the center of the plate. They're called strike three.
Well, that's been a really good pitch for him. Faltini, big blow of this ball game. Leadoff double, came in to score in the second inning.
Seven strikeouts for Farr. Four have been looking.
Didn't get to call on that one. And it's 1-0. Misses again out there. Good hitting pitch coming.
Trey's been swinging the bat. He should get a good pitch, good fastball to hit right here. See what he can do with it.
Boy, he put a good swing on it. Fouled it straight back. The 2-1. Right side. Wind will blow this back, but it stays out of play.
No catch. He's going to get it back. He got it back.
Oh, he got it back, but he's got to get an E, doesn't he? He's got to be
a miscue. He was camped under. It wasn't.
Ball ripped into the gap again on a hanging breaking ball. Faltini has his second hit of the night. One out single.
Your eyes light up when you see a breaking ball like this just kind of roll in there. Oh.
You're happy as a pitcher that stayed in the ballpark.
Yeah, it should go about 500 feet. But it didn't. Went about 150 feet, and Faltini has a single.
Melendez steps in. He walked his first time up. Good speed at first for Texas. Foul back to the screen. Texas has out hit South Carolina 5-1 in this ball game. But we're tied here at one. Far set. Quickly, it's 0-2 to Melendez.
Look at that smile. Had to go up on top of the dugout to get that one.
Yeah, but he got it. It's got him. That's the fifth multiple hit game of the season for Faltini. And I'm telling you, when you want it, you got to find a way to go get it.
Yeah, watch it. He's in a race. Sister's right there with him.
I got to go.
One
yes,
knee
sir.
One knee on the wall and makes the grab. Batting glove on the right hand. Ready to go.
Boy, he's excited.
I'll let you hold it for a second. Now it's time to get I got it. You got, I'm going home with it. You can have your cotton candy. I'm going to keep the ball.
The 1-2. There goes the runner. Throw to second base. Is in time. And that is shaky. It looks like that was very close. Don't think we're going to have a replay.
Take a look. Throws up. Well, might have got him on the top of the shoulder. Watch before Trey's hand hits the bag, right? No, he didn't. I don't know.
The throw was up. The runner is out. No appeal. Catches the outside corner. Eighth strikeout for Farr. We're through four, tied at one. Friday night in the live music capital of the world. We can't wait till we get back there. It is so nice to see UFCU Dishfog Field with at least 25% capacity here tonight. This place would be full with South Carolina in town if obviously what we've been going through. It's been almost a year. Just over a year. And so it's just nice to see people back at the ballpark and see two great universities with excellent programs able to play baseball.
We did not play this game this time last year, the Friday night.
Friday night game is when it was over. Colin Burgess will step in. First pitch from Madden, misses upstairs. We're glad to be back. Glad college baseball is back. This should be an outstanding series. The 1-0 from Madden upstairs, and it's 2-0. When you're struggling with command, it's just he just hasn't been what we've seen him in his other starts this season. You have to really reach down. I know as a hitter when I was struggling, I had to, all right, I need to go back and I got to readjust here. What do I need to do something different? Pitching, is that the same thing?
It's the mental aspect because, you know, wait a minute, I've struck out 26 guys in the last two games to get up three hits. Now I've walked three. I haven't struck out, but only three. So, yeah, the aspect is like, wait, I'm not overpowering. Now I have to go back and really concentrate on getting the ball down. I've had struggle doing that. You concentrate more on mechanics and getting the ball down. That one right there had a good tilt on it and good location. So it's when you get to the middle innings of games and you start to get tired, you got to really concentrate, use your mechanics, use your legs, and that gets you through maybe the sixth, seventh, eighth inning. Now you can turn it over to the bullpen.
You know you still got 45 pitches left in you. You know, you went 110 in your last outing. You're a big, strong young man. You've been preparing. You threw on Tuesday to get prepared for this. So this is one of those where you got to try to find it and get back to it.
Like that right there. Really stayed back over the rubber and used the tilt on the fastball.
Remember, really nice at bat.
Back to back. Yeah.
His last at bat was a good at bat. He was 0-2 with the bases loaded. Drove a ball deep enough to get a sac fly.
Father Chris was a two-time All-American at Wichita State.
Fouled it back.
There's now you're starting to repeat the windup. Three fastballs in the exact location. Now, Zonk, you go to that slider that starts in the same location as those fastballs.
And breaks it out of the zone.
And you can get a swing and miss right here.
Did he go? Yes, he did.
Easy from up here, isn't it?
Well, you've done it once or twice, big boy.
But he's had it. It wasn't really the location that he wanted, but it worked out. First base umpire says, yes, you did. Fourth strikeout for Ty Madden.
Well, as an ex-hitter, I'm not sure that barrel got across the plate, but that's it's just a hitter's mentality.
You're a broadcaster, Zonk.
One time I was a hitter, though.
Yes, and a very good one at that. Matter of fact, in 75, you batted
.410. I can't remember, .410.
Yeah, I can't remember. Yeah, I had 19 doubles and 69 RBIs. And that's a true statement right there. You did have 69 RBIs.
Well, okay. I don't remember that.
He had one big double. We saw that.
The 1-1. Downstairs. We're getting, though, what you kind of felt like you were going to get in this first ball game. You got two Friday night guys. You know, every team in the SEC's got a Friday night guy that's going to be difficult to score on.
A lot of them have Friday and Saturday.
Yes. Fouled off right side. Ty Madden has been everything of what a Friday night guy is supposed to be for Texas.
Yeah, he'll be out there for 100, 110 before we would see any action, unless he gets in trouble, of course.
The 2-2 to Khalil on the ground to first. Zubia has it, steps on the bag. The Gamecocks down here in the fifth. 4.5 in the books. 1-1 ball game. Warm, breezy evening here in Austin, Texas. Texas has 5 hits, but only 1 run. South Carolina has produced their run on only 1 hit. So we're halfway home, 4.5 in the books. Keith Moreland, Greg Swindell, glad you're with us. Last conference weekend, non-conference weekend for most of the nation. Now the ACC already involved in conference play. Some of the teams out west starting into conference play. So this is one of those, though, you love to see these matchups. I mean, Oklahoma State and Vanderbilt's another one this weekend going on.
I was just going to check that one.
So you've got some really good series.
Ty Madden's had 7 groundouts, and I like to pay attention to the goofy little stat. 4 of them have been to Zubia, unassisted. 3 unassisted.
You don't see that very often.
Not too often.
8-9-1. Due for Texas against Thomas Farr, who's really done a nice job. He scattered 5 hits. Texas has only produced 1 run. Fouled off right side, out of play. 94 miles an hour on that heater. 70th pitch of the ball game coming. The Gamecock right-hander.
Raining in Stillwater, postponed. No Vanderbilt, Oklahoma State game tonight.
Well, could be a double dip tomorrow. As a right-handed hitter, I would.
You'll get a rocker and lighter tomorrow.
Same day. It could be an 0-for-8 with some punch outs. 1-1, foul back. And it's 1-2.
It's pretty great how these two teams got to play each other this year.
Absolutely.
Right? Both of them had cancellations for the weekend. There's a network, a portal that you can go into and see what teams are playing and not playing, and both teams were off. So coaches got together. Coach Kingston's like, well, we don't want to have someone come in and beat them 18-0, 19-0. We want Let's go down to Austin and play some baseball.
And Texas will return that favor next year and make the trip to South Carolina. Williams down on strike. That's the ninth for Thomas Farr in this game. Mitchell Daly with the biggest blow of the ball game for Texas. RBI single his first time up. Breaking ball right back to the mound. Underhands the first and two quick outs for the Horns here in the fifth.
After since getting into trouble in the second inning and giving up the one and getting out of it, that's 11 straight. 10 straight retired by Farr.
You can see his history.
37th round. He's an academic honor roll as well. Ninth strikeout is career high for Thomas Farr.
Inside out, into right center. Hoda with a big turn. Is he going to try for two? He is not. What a nice job. We highlighted him in the open because he's moving into a spot for a veteran leadoff hitter. Boy, he's done a nice job tonight.
Yeah, you see, stays inside the ball. We say that. He didn't try to roll over, didn't try to pull it. Kept his hands in and took the breaking ball to right. Ball was elevated.
And that's what, if you try to pull that ball, even though it's elevated, you roll it over to short.
Well, you roll it over or hit it on the I-35. Foul.
Kennedy steps in. Eric, bunt single his first time up. Strikeout victim in the third. I think you've got to run here if you're Texas and use your speed at the top of this order. Kennedy steps back in. Quick move. Hodo back in. Cat and mouse game between runner, pitcher, and catcher is really real intricate. Upstairs, and it's 2-0. I've always thought that there's so many games you can come set, go quick. As a catcher, you can come set, tell you got to step off. I can help you to keep remind you, hey, now back off.
Yeah. I had a catcher that would just shake his hand, like, shake me off. And if you shake off enough, somebody's going to call time.
Yep.
Either the hitter or the catcher. And then get right back in there and give you a sign, and not quick pitch, but though in a hurry. Just everything's rhythm and timing, pitching, hitting, and base run. We always were told to make the good base runners come to a stop. They want to get that walk and lead. Oh, that way they can just take off whenever.
Great lead here. 2-0 not going. Swing and a miss by Kennedy. Still a really live fastball.
94 on that one. Coach Kingston said he has a power arm. The velocity is going to be there. True so far.
Not going again. Fastball catches the outside corner. And quickly it's 2-2.
If I'm far, I don't worry about Hodo.
Not now.
He's got a career high 9 strikeouts. He's feeling it. It's the last thing you need in your head is if the runner going. If he's going, don't worry about it. You can strike out the hitter.
Foul back. We'll do it again at 2-2. Yeah, I mean, catchers are always worried. I want my stealing percentage low, but I got 2 strikes now on the hitter. You work with me and let's get this guy. We don't have to worry about throwing.
Don't have to worry about it.
First pitch of the game coming. Throw over first.
And when you get strikeouts, so do pitch counts.
Pitch
they
counts
go up. Will start to rise when you get a lot of strikeouts. That's what was so odd about Ty Madden's last outing, 110 pitches and had 14 strikeouts.
There goes the runner. Pitches downstairs. Throw to second. In time. Outstanding throw by Burgess to throw him out.
Yeah, that was on the money. The one to Faltini a little high. This throw right here. Inside fastball. Gets rid of it. Quick tag by Khalil. Tied at one. Going to six.
We went to break, but at the end of it, they asked for a review of this play. So the umpires are taking a look at this. Get a chance to see right here. Boy, I tell you what, the call on the field was out. I have not seen anything to this point that would overturn that.
Yeah, the tag was applied so quick by Khalil out there. Yeah, there's nothing that shows that he was way ahead of the tag.
This may be our best opportunity. Center field camera as we slow this down. I believe he got him right before the left foot came to the bag. He caught him up on the calf. But is there enough to say that he was safe there?
Right.
Or out?
Might not be enough to overturn that one.
Let's see what they come out here with. Here comes the call. Is out. So it is confirmed.
Burgess saying, I told you. I told you I got him.
Well, you know, Zeke, we've looked at this game. We sort of got what we thought we were going to get because you got two great Friday night guys. Both of them to this point. Now we've had seven hits in the game, six of those by Texas. But Farr's made big pitches when he needed to. And Texas has not run the bases well, hadn't been successful running the bases. On the other side, Madden really struggled in that one inning, but he made pitches when he needed to limit the damage.
Yeah, Farr had him on the ropes in the first and the second, just gave up the one run. Madden walked three in the second, only one run. So the pitchers have settled down. We talked about it. If you get them early, you might have a chance, but both Farr and Madden have settled in, retiring consecutive hitters. And Silver had to go to the bullpen, but an outstanding Friday night game between two great programs.
Well, you just look at it, and both pitchers, they probably will get through the sixth here and maybe into the seventh. This game more than likely may be in the hands of the bullpen.
Yeah, it's looking that way with the pitch counts, 80 for Farr, 74 now for Madden. If he could get a quick inning right here, might get a couple more out of him. But it has been the pitcher's duel we were thinking, talking about. But so far, just two runs total on the scoreboard.
Top of the order, dude. For the Gamecocks here in the sixth. As Allen steps in, 0 for 2. Great play by Kennedy to take a base hit away from Allen his last time up.
Sinking liners aren't easy to judge off the bat.
On the ground. Faltini to his right. Long throw across the diamond. Outstanding play by the Longhorn shortstop.
Well, people at home, you don't know really how good this is. You got Cam Williams diving in front of you. You got to concentrate on the ball, and the transition from glove to throwing arm right there is what does it. Don't have to have a strong throw, especially when you're going away from the play, just accurate. He got rid of it, made a great play.
Satterfield will step in. He's 0 for 2. Well, that play is not near as easy as Faltini made it look.
Well, sixth inning, you just kept the leadoff hitter off the base by making a great play.
Oh-1, back up the middle. It's going to be a tough, difficult play. Faltini again. One to his right, one to his left.
Sometimes you got to let it breathe, right, Zolt?
Wow.
Goes to that one's even more difficult. He's playing where Mitchell Daly usually plays. the second base position, having to throw back across the body. I mean, that's two of the best plays you'll see by a shortstop this season. And made it look easy.
Yep. One to his right, one to his left. And Wes Clark steps in.
Cam Williams and Mitchell Daly, they can just go in and sit down on the bench. Trace covering everything out there.
Clark relying to right. It's first time up and a nice play by Hodo to go into the corner. And grounded to second on a 3-0 pitch. So he's 0 for 2 as he steps in. Leads the nation in big flies. Breaking ball downstairs. The count evens.
I would think you would want to stay away from this big man. Try to get him to chase something in the dirt. Stay away from him with the fastball.
If you come in, you got to come in off the plate.
Make him hit it.
If he's going to pull it foul.
In the parking lot over there.
Breaking ball stays away, and it's 2-1 to Clark.
There are times in series where you talk about don't let this guy beat you. This is the one for South Carolina. You don't want to let this guy beat you. So wait, we're in the sixth inning. What do you mean beat it? Well, if he hits a homer, runs are
hard to come by.
Hard to come by in this game. Try to keep him in the park. Big pitch right here.
Painted him down and away, and the count goes full. As a hitter, I'm looking for a pitch I can pop. I can't do anything. I can't slug that pitch.
He's looking to hit it 500 feet. You're not going to do it with that pitch.
No, sir.
Wouldn't be surprised to see that slider right here.
Challenged him away, fouled it off. We'll do it again 3-2. Still plenty of giddy up. 84th pitch at 95 miles an hour from Ty Madden.
I think Ty recognizes the moment. He's reaching back. They call this reaching back a little bit. Try to get that little extra.
Seventh pitch of the at-bat coming. Just ripped. Challenged him with a heater. And Clark ripped it into left center for the second hit of the night for the Gamecocks. That's fun to watch guys that can hit and guys that can chunk it.
They went after him, 3-2 count. You'll take a single into left center from Wes Clark. What happened, Trey? Couldn't make that one?
No, well, he was over in the hole.
I'm kidding.
Yeah, okay. Well, he had to lay out to get that one. Down the left field line, fading away from Kennedy. Kennedy get a long run. Look out. That wall is hard. It is padded. Slides to slow his momentum down. Can't come up with it.
Well, you love the effort. Challenging the fan out there as well. Breaks his run. So, yeah, a couple years ago, wasn't there some cement at the bottom? So they've made the padding go all the way to the bottom
all the way
of the
down.
Turf.
Inside and 1-1. Steps back in. Boy, that's a late timeout.
The umpire waited a little too long. Seidler was asking for time. The umpire just waited a second or so too long, especially once Ty already lifted his leg.
Got comes set again. Now the 1-1.
Talking about cat and mouse.
Yeah, that's Ty was not throwing that. He said, you're going to wait on me. We will get a pitch here soon. Madden set. 1-1, way upstairs, and it's 2-1. Ty Madden has yielded 5 base hits, folks. 9 innings, 1 hit, 2 starts ago. Ball back through the box, nice piece of hitting. Back-to-back base hits for the first time in the game for South Carolina. But he's given up 1, 2, and now 3. So 6 hits in his last 3 appearances on the mound.
Sean Allen out again to have a word with Ty Madden. 16, last 20-plus innings. 6 hits.
Well, you look at the number. This will be the 90th pitch when he comes with it. He went 110, but he has had, that's the other thing. He had a long outing, complete game. Now this is that third time out, and he's approaching 90 pitches now. So, and these have been stressful, no question. You're facing an offensive team like South Carolina.
Second inning with 3 walks. Pitch count got up. That's stressful inning. Kind of settled in. So first trouble he's been in since the second.
Eisler will step in. Singled his last time up. Fastball catches the corner for strike one. He singled on a 1-2 breaking ball where he went back through the box. Struck out in the second. Popped up, playable right side. Zubia calls, makes the play to end the inning. Trey Faltini. Tell you what, this is as good as it can be done.
Gold Glover right here. Goes to his left, gets the out. Goes to his right, excuse me, now to the left. 2 great plays by the shortstop for Texas.
In the second, all the scoring in this ball game. Sacrifice fly by Braden Wimmer. Right field, South Carolina takes a 1-0 lead. And then Mitchell Daly back through the box. First and third, RBI single. That's been all the scoring in the game. A lot of zeros since that time. Thomas Farr, career high with 9 strikeouts. He's out here for his 6th inning of work. Let's see the numbers for Ty Madden. 2-3-4 due here for Texas in the home half of the 6th.
Farr has gone 6 innings twice this season. First and second start. Last start he went 5 1/3.
Do you find that patterns develop, you know, when guys have a tough time pushing through to get to the 7th? Is that something that you would be looking at here? Pitches upstairs.
Yeah, I mean, your 4th start, you haven't had the opportunity, but you're not really getting hurt in this ball game. Your pitch count's starting to get up there. You do have a good bullpen. That's what Coach Kingston talks about. We have a lot of arms that we can mix and match with, so maybe that could be a reason too. You don't need to go more than 6. They've scoring a lot of runs. But this is a really tight ball game. Tied at 1 here in the bottom of the 6th.
2-1 to Kennedy. Inside corner. And it's 2-2. That has been a really big pitch for Thomas Farr tonight. That two-seamer, he starts off the plate against left-handers and tails it back to the inside corner. The 2-2. Breaking ball inside, and the count goes full. And action starting to take place.
Jack Mahoney getting loose down there. Another one limbering up. Brett Carey.
Popped up in the infield. Whoa, the snow cone effect. Don't want to do that one all over again. Halil. George that time looking up. This wind, it's difficult to catch a fly ball. Watch this right at the end.
Whoop. Oopsie.
Able to hold on, though, for the out. And Chico stepping in. He's 0 for 2 in this one. He's been a strikeout victim twice. Backdoor breaking ball. Misses for ball one. Hit crisply on the ground. Better hurry, not in time.
Mendham got to this ball easily, but waited a little too long. You got to get rid of that ball to Farr so he can get to the bag, give it to him a step closer. That's a close play right there.
Chance to look at it again right here.
Correct.
Ty goes to the runner.
Correct call. See the last little stutter step. That's why you get the ball to the pitcher a step earlier so he doesn't have to disrupt his timing with his feet. That cost him a base run.
Seventh hit of the game for Texas. First for Antico as Zubia steps in. Zach 0 for 2. Breaking ball, misses outside for ball one.
Really close plays in this game. Hard to tell in slow motion on the replay.
Yeah. Tight ball games. Two good teams. It's going to boil down to everything's going to be close. I expect it'll be that way all weekend long. Seven already for Mike. Threat to run at any time.
Center fielder thing. Duke on that list right there. 2019, 17.
The other part of it is South Carolina defensively has done a nice job against the steal in this ballgame. Slowed the running game down. Breaking ball stays up. Good hitter's pitch coming for Zubia. 90 pitches now under his belt.
You would think Thomas Farr, they got it. They start their conference schedule coming up with Vanderbilt. Can't do that. You want to have him fresh next week as well.
Good swing, fouled it straight back. Had something to handle right there. Always felt like in every at bat, more times than not, I was going to get a pitch to handle. I better take advantage of it because a lot of times guys that got good stuff, it ain't going to happen again in that at bat.
That was a very hittable fastball.
Zubia steps back in. There goes the runner. Pitches outside. Throw to second base. And Antico as his eighth of the year. Tough pitch to throw on.
Yeah, got a jump. Looks in. Pitch was low and away. Very hard for Burgess to throw out Antico on that.
So go ahead run. 180 feet away at second base. Fifth three ball count for Farr on the night, but he's only walked one batter.
A lot of pitches, but getting the outs.
Time out here. We're going to have a conversation.
Thomas Farr even holding his hands up like, what is this about? Counts 2-2. It is a weird time to run out there and have a conversation. Sprinted out there, the Skylar Meade. And back in.
Short conversation and it's over. Zubia steps back in. Breaking ball, he went around. 10th strikeout, double digits for Thomas Farr.
Another nasty breaking ball right there to Zach. See the breaking ball started him away and then up and in seems to be the theme. Gets a hittable fastball, fouls it straight back. And Tico gets the stolen base and then comes back with a breaking ball to Zach.
So, here it comes. Let's go now. So Zubi, after the ball went by, when he went out and did like that to protect the runner, they called that a strike. Had to be. So that's the way it was confusing because the umpire never raised his right hand but one time, but it was the protection. And Antico still.
You did see Antico peek in.
Yeah, and he put his bat over the plate. And that's where the strike. That's why it was confusion of 3-1 or 2-2. So 0-1 to Ardoin. Right side off of the screen. And quickly, Farr's done a nice job when he's gotten in trouble of making big pitches. He's a pitch away, getting out of it here in the sixth.
95 pitches for Farr tonight.
Really good outing. He scattered seven hits. And as the ball game started, he gave up back-to-back base hits.
He's given up a hit every inning but the third, and that one he struck out the side.
The 0-2. Breaking ball upstairs, and it's 1-2.
Here it comes, right here. Here it comes. Let's go. Here it comes. Let's go now.
What do you go to here, Zeke?
He's had success with the breaking ball and the fastball. If he wants a strikeout, I think he goes to the breaking ball like he did Zubia.
Long look in, shakes a couple of times. Now set and ready to go. Fastball popped up, back out of play.
Burgess wanted that one a little bit higher. Pretty good night for the redshirt junior right there. Career high in 10 strikeouts so far.
On the road. That's definitely a quality start for me.
Right here, Longo. Here it comes. I see you, Barry.
Very well could be his last pitch. I think they'd love to get him through this frame and go to the bullpen. The 1-2 again. Breaking ball misses outside. The count goes even at 2-2. I do not think they'll let him face Valtini, who is 2-for-2 against him.
That is number.
Here it comes. Let's go. Here it
So for Favre to stay in the game, he's got to get Silas Ardoin, who is 0 for 2 with two strikeouts as he steps in here. Great speed at second base. Breaking ball popped up, playable in the infield. Makes the play as Wimmer, and that ends the inning. Two-thirds of the game in the books. Nothing decided here. 1-1 ball game.
Ty Madden, the ace for the Horns, taking the ball against the Gamecocks here on a fabulous Friday night. He's had it working, just ran into trouble in the second with a few walks and one run. But only three singles in this ball game for Ty Madden, really having to fight himself on the mound, but that's what good pitchers do right there through six innings. Three hits, just one run earned, three walks, four strikeouts. 22 innings now in his last three starts. Still just one earned run and 29 strikeouts.
Well, you just look at the scenario at 91 pitches. They would love to get him through this seventh inning. Two-thirds of the ball game in the books. Nothing decided here. 1-1 ball game. This ball fouled off at the plate, and that hurt as Ardoin took that one directly. Tough young man, but I guarantee you that's like a punch.
Did it hit the mask? Did it get under it? Right on the side of it. Ouch. Got to give him a breather here for a second.
I've wore those pieces of equipment. You do have things that come down over the sides. You can see his throat protector. But still, that's like taking a punch.
It's coming in at 95 miles an hour.
There's padding on that mask, but not a lot. And then take another one. Again, tools of ignorance.
Back to back. It's a changeup from Madden. Just foul tip and gets right up underneath Silas Ardoin.
Is there anything you're not hurting yet? Just let the rest of the ball game go. Something else will get hit. The 0-2. Did he go? Boy, he offered. He got close to offering outside.
He did. It's another changeup.
He has walked 0 for 1 in the ballgame. Inside corner, got him. Great pitch by Madden. Fifth strikeout of the ballgame.
95th pitch by Madden. Perfect location, inner half. What's the little hop on the end right there by Ty? He knew it, felt it, and got the call.
Colin Burgess will step in. He has walked and grounded to first. He's been really good behind the plate tonight. 0 for 1 in the ballgame at the plate. The 1-0 from Madden. Chop foul at the plate.
One catcher hits one off himself now. Not even behind the plate and they're getting hit.
You gotta be tough. Pounded it in the ground again and it's 1-2. And nobody, and then you as a pitcher know, nobody gets more respect than catchers do from pitchers.
Oh, you have to. They get back there. Well, you call them the tools of ignorance. It's just not really.
Breaking ball, knock down, put your body in front of it, smother it in case the guy swings.
Yeah, it's a special relationship between these two. Coach Pierce talked about it. I mean, it's not just the camaraderie as pitcher and catcher. They're friends, I mean, obviously teammates, and hang out. When you develop relationships like that, get on each other, you can talk to each other.
You can learn from each other.
Learn from each other. Pretty good pitch here, just a little down.
Do it again. Here comes the payoff. 101. Chop foul at the plate. Braden Wimmer awaits on deck. The 3-2 again. Right side. Down the right field line. Ball may be coming back. Just runs out of real estate to Zubia. If you're looking at your guide, there's a change in game time tomorrow. Instead of 6:30, moved up because of inclement weather expected tomorrow evening. It is a 2:30 start here on LHN. On the ground, fifth time in the ball game, three unassisted for the second out of the inning.
Two in a row by Burgess. Probables for DeMar. Brannon Jordan making his fourth start. 23 strikeouts. Good ERA. Tristan Stevens had some bad luck of leaving runners on and they're scoring. That's why his ERA is like it is. He's thrown ball better than a 0-1 and a 5 ERA.
Sure has. First pitch out to right, coming on quickly as Hodo puts it away, and Madden through the seventh. Seventh inning stretch time. We're tied here at one. Thomas Farr was just outstanding, Zeke.
Yeah, Texas had him on the ropes the first couple of innings, but he made pitches when he had to. Found the breaking ball, really located the fastball. Only gave up the one run, but the breaking ball was outstanding tonight. And like I said, when he needed to make pitches, he did. A career high 10 strikeouts, 6 innings, 1 run. It was earned and 1 walk. He'll leave in a tie ball game and give way to Jack Mahoney. Freshman right-hander, 6'6", 210 pounds out of Arlington Heights, Illinois. Last outing, March 7th against Mercer, went 2 1/3 innings, so he can go multiple innings. Good ERA, only 4 hits and 7 2/3 and 0 walks and 11 strikeouts. Good arm on this freshman.
And he comes on here in what is a tie ball game. Mahoney will face Trey Faltini, who has doubled and scored and singled. Thrown out trying to steal second in this ball game, but 2 for 2 as he steps in. He's been hot as of late. Only first pitch in there for a strike. Good live arm. Arlington Heights, Illinois. Upstairs. Evens at 1-1. You know, you get those guys coming out of the bullpen. One of the strengths for the Gamecocks has been their bullpen. Well, that's a great pitch right there. But you want to put them in these type of environments on the road. You're going to find out how your bullpen reacts coming on the road in a tie game, and you have to go to them.
Yeah. I mean, the numbers speak for themselves. Has not walked a batter this season. Struck out 11. 12.
Dynamite pitch right there. Just dotted the eye on the outside corner.
Yeah, it came back. See Burgess set up away, and again, the tailing fastball comes back on the outer half.
At the top of the strike zone. Somebody is getting a note passed to him, written about him. Somebody in the Longhorn dugout might have been ejected there.
Well, Texas has already had a little fun with Jason Millsap this year. Might have been too low. He looks like he's heading to the locker room.
Looks like his night is done.
Well, he's passionate. He loves what he's doing here at Texas, and sometimes it can happen. David Pierce getting his worth. You see Tulo up there on the top step on the left of the screen. Gets the point.
Taking his mask down, and he made one more comment right there.
Still didn't see.
I didn't see
any ejection. So now Jason Millsap has got David Pierce and Troy Tulowitzki this year.
Melendez will step in. Honey's first pitch, chop foul. Quickly, it's 0-1. Melendez with big time power. Sophomore from El Paso. Takes that pitch for a strike.
Well, he just took it for strike three, so you know he's calling it. You have to protect around the plate. As much as you can disagree, he's calling it right now.
Don't think he's going to change anything. Here comes the 0-2. Swing and a miss, got him on the outside. Back-to-back strikeouts here in the home half of the seventh.
Just a fastball down and away right there. As a hitter's on, I mean, that one was pretty low, but you have to protect now that you know the zone is opened up.
If the zone's open up now as a hitter, get a little closer to plate and go to hacking.
Yeah.
That's, you know.
That's what Melendez did right there.
I mean, but you don't start it with two strikes. And that's what Cam Williams did. He walked up there and went to say, I'm swinging at the first thing I see, and he just ripped it to right. Sometimes the umpire can set the tone of what I'm going to do offensively.
You don't need to let him do that.
So the two-out single, the eighth hit of the game for Texas. That brings up Mitchell Daly. He's one for two. His one drove in the only run of the game for the Horns. So Daly comes set as he comes to the plate. Pitches up and away. In the second, Daly comes to the plate. It's a fastball away right here. Rips it back through the box. That's how Texas got on the board. Williams from first, 1-0, misses outside, and it's 2-0 to Daly. Honey takes a big breath, grabs the rosin bag. Now he knows he's got to come for a strike in a hitter's count.
Fastballs have all been away. I would, like you said, put your toes on the white line and go to hacking.
Way outside, and it's 3-0. Odo waits on deck. He's had a big ball game. He's 2-for-3. Opportunity here. Back-to-back strikeouts. First pitch single, and now three consecutive out of the zone. The 3-0. Outside, ball four.
First walk of the year given up by Jack Mahoney. Could be huge for Texas.
Douglas singled and was stranded at third in the first. Flied to right and then singled with two outs in the fifth. So he's 2-for-3 as he steps in. Texas has struggled with runners in scoring position. 1-for-8 tonight. Wimmer moves in behind Williams there at second base, keeping him mighty close.
He was playing up the middle with Daly up.
Pitch misses outside, just like that. Five in a row. Not close.
Almost where you couldn't throw a ball, and now you can't throw a strike. It's that mental part of the ball game.
Activity again in the Gamecock bullpen.
Will Sanders.
Odo steps back in. Long pause for Mahoney. The 1-0. Breaking ball in there for strike. If you can't throw your fastball for strike, what do you go to?
This is a veteran catcher back there. Went out, had a talk with him, and a lot of times when after a talk, you're going to see a fastball. But Burgess goes out there and says, hey, let's get back in the zone here with the breaking ball.
So the count evens. Set and checks the runners. Fastball catches the outside corner. Longhorn fans don't like it, but it's 1-2. Now he's got lots of options, Zeke.
Yeah, now you got to protect if you're Doug Hodo. You know the zone now is low and high. I mean, it could be anywhere right now. So anything close, you got to be swinging.
Outfield very shallow, trying to cut this run off at the plate. Very shallow. The 1-2. Fastball outside corner. Strike three call. As Mahoney strikes out the side after giving up a single and a walk. Outside corner. We go to the eighth. 1-1.
Ty Madden taking the ball for the Horns this Friday night against South Carolina. Gamecocks came out, throwing the ball well, struggling with command early in the ball game, but found it, ended up with five strikeouts, two looking on the night, seven innings, three hits, just one run, one earned run, his first, only one earned run in his last 22 innings. He'll give way to Aaron Nixon.
Aaron Nixon, true freshman from McCallum High School. 0-1 on the season. That was the walk-off last Saturday down in Houston, but has thrown the ball really well. Power fastball, nearly to the mid-90s, and a power breaking ball. He's made one bad pitch in his college career, and it cost him a loss, a hanging breaking ball. But you can see his numbers right there. 5 Ks and 4 1/3 innings, and he comes on here. In the eighth inning, you want to get him right back out there. And here he is back in a very tight game against a good team.
Yeah, ball really gets out of Nixon's hand. Throws the ball well. And as a reliever, you have to have a short memory. You can't worry about what you did yesterday because you're going to get the ball again. Yeah, it's been about 6 days since he gave up the walk-off. But you can't think about that when you're out on the mound now and throw strikes and get that leadoff hitter. And he does that.
Well, you got to have, like you said, if you're a reliever, you've got to have a short memory. This is the last time he was on the mound. That's what he remembers. See, it was a breaking ball, and I'm telling you what, put a charge into it, ended the game, and you have to walk off in that kind of fashion. But I like his stuff, and I think there was a heck of a growing experience. You don't want to learn something by losing a game, but you do learn something from losing the game.
You learn more from losing than you do winning. I mean, in my opinion, because now you know the feeling. You don't want to feel that again. You try to make a better pitch. He didn't mean to hang and break a ball. He did. It went out of the park, but you have to forget about it. Been there. I've been there, done that. And best thing that can happen is get the ball the next day. Well, in college, you can't really do that. You have to wait a little bit. Get back out there and throw strikes. And right now, he's doing that with the same. He could throw the same break ball tonight, and someone will pop it up.
Yeah, well, as Coach Pierce talked to him and said, hey, you can't, you know why you're not going to pitch if you hang a breaking ball, and you know, but you learn from it. All right, I understand what you were saying back in the fall. He's got good stuff, and I think he's going to make lots of contributions to this club here in 2021. He's a two-way guy. He's also an infielder. Just like all pitchers, he thinks he can hit. Probably can. One and two to Allen. 0 for 3 in this one as he steps in. Check swing. Made a mistake with it upstairs. That's not where you want to miss with it.
You know, sometimes, like you said, the one that went left the park last week, now you try to force it. Try to force it in there. You overthrow it and you hang it.
2-2. Downstairs, and the count goes full. Satterfield awaits on deck. The payoff. Inside corner, strike three call.
Fastball. Ardoin sets up away, but it runs back to the inner half. Got the call. Anytime you can get that leadoff hitter, talking about Brady Allen being the leadoff hitter in the spot there, keep him off the base in front of the boppers.
Absolutely.
Pinch hitter.
Malone, Brendan Malone will be the pinch hitter. As Malone steps in, first pitch fastball in there for a strike. Sophomore, Woodstock, Georgia, 6 foot, 200 pounder. Another excellent fastball. That is a perfect location for that two-seamer. Just bring it. Don't change anything.
Well, I always say don't try to end the at-bat too soon. When you do that by trying to make that perfect pitch, let the everything take care of itself. When you try it, it might run back over the middle.
0-2 again. Came right back to it, and it did get more of the middle. You're absolutely right.
That's the situation where you need to go a little few more inches outside. Don't try to make the perfect pitch in an 0-2 count.
See the numbers, Brennan.
You can try that slider in that spot right here.
The 0-2 again. Breaking ball, just gets a piece of it.
Well, if that one over the plate right there too.
It's like real estate. It's location, location, location.
Well, you can try the fastball up and away right here.
Breaking ball, good one. Gets the strikeout. Back to back. 1-2-3 goes South Carolina in the eighth. We go to the bottom of the eighth in a 1-1 ball game.
Longhorn Network Baseball is presented by Tiff's Treats. Tiff's Treats cookie delivery, baked to order, delivered warm, and in part by Whataburger. Try the patty melt today. It's an all-time favorite for a reason. And American Campus Communities, where students love living.
Great view on a Friday night of Congress Avenue. A 1-1 ball game as we go to the bottom of the eighth, and the Gamecocks go to the bullpen for the second time, and they will bring in Will Sanders. He is a 6'6", 208-pound freshman from Atlanta, Georgia. Woodward Academy. You can see the numbers right there. He's been really good. This is his seventh appearance.
Another reliever coming out of that bullpen. But a lot of strikeouts, no walks. SEC Freshman of the Week, March 1st. Last pitch a couple days ago against the Citadel, won an inning in the third, just a couple of hits and no runs.
Malone stays in the game. He's at third base. He came on to pinch hit. You could see that Sanders didn't see the signs. He was pointing to his eyes, can't see. May have to go to some kind of outside. Yeah, so you can see right there.
Well, that means it's not a one.
Yeah, I would think the same thing.
You can see the one go down easy.
If you can't see what's going on, is South Carolina does have some more guys headed down to the bullpen.
You better look that way.
Well, but you may have to use something on outside touches to figure out what sign you use. Meat of the Texas order. 2-3-4 due here in a 1-1 ball game. One run, three hits, no miscues for South Carolina. 1-8-0 for Texas. Kennedy, as he steps in, he's 1-for-3. A bunt single his first time up. Rips this ball into the right field corner. That goes fair. Kennedy on his way to second. Makes a big turn. He's headed for three. Got outstanding speed. Here comes the relay. Not in time. Leadoff triple, Eric Kennedy.
First triple of the year for Eric Kennedy, jumping on that first one from Sanders. Just stays inside the line, hits the padding down there, down the right field line, and stops. Doesn't get completely into the corner. Eric Kennedy's going to pick up David Pearson. He's got him on his way right here. Leadoff triple, and South Carolina will have to bring the infield in right here.
A leadoff triple. Tico steps in. He is 1-for-3. He singled his last time up. Off speed, checks his swing. Didn't go around, but infield is drawn up here.
First triple of the season for Kennedy, now tied for the team lead with Zubia.
Sneaky wheels. Sanders set. Downstairs, and it's 2-0. Are you greeted with a triple on your first pitch? Now you got a left-hander and a right-hander in the meat of the order coming. Now you're 2-0 with two off-speed pitches.
I still have a challenge right here. Because either way, if you walk him and Zubia's up, you still can't play.
That's a balk.
Called a balk.
It's just warned him?
What's a warning?
You can't warn a guy for a balk, can you?
We playing the clock? What's going on here?
Might have gone to... I think that's a warning for going maybe...
He didn't... Your normal set position isn't up here. He normally stops. You have to stop before you step off. And he stopped, not in his normal position. So it was all one continuous move where he stepped off, where you have to come set and then step off.
I agree. You stopped play, but didn't call a balk. Time must have been called at the plate. It's the only thing I can think of.
Maybe Burgess did it? Just quick thinking? I don't know. Either way, it's a 2-0 count, and Antico should get something to hit right here.
Popped up. Will it get into the stands? Yes, it does. And it's 2-1 to Antico. Contact middle of the field as a hitter. As a pitcher, this is when you need that strikeout or a pop up in the infield. Almost hit him inside, and it's 3-1. Kennedy will not be on contact here with nobody out, so he's laying back by the bag. He will make the ball clear on the ground in the infield.
Texas has hurt themselves in this ball game with some base running. You'd hate to do it right here.
Three-one, way upstairs, and it's 3-1. It's a walk, excuse me. That puts runners at first and third here for Zubia.
Both Mahoney and Sanders coming into these games without a walk out of the bullpen. Both of them have walked a hitter. So that's Sanders' first of the season. Brett Thomas, Parker Coyne. Double barrel down there in the bullpen. Infield still in. You have to.
Yeah, you got to try to cut this run off the plate. You can't go to double play depth and surrender the run. You got three outs left offensively. Trying to keep the score tied here. This is when you're looking for that strikeout. Now, if there's one out, I think you move the infield back and try to go for the double play. But with no outs, you have to stay up. So Zubia digs in.
I don't think Antico might be trying to get second.
Second of the night for Antico. So infield up. Pitch was downstairs, and it's 1-0 to Zubia. Time called again by Zubia. Breaking ball. Did he go? No, he did not. Quickly, it's 2-0 to Zubia.
I wouldn't be if he doesn't see a pitch to hit right here. You do have a base open. You got a base open. So Zach Zubia has been the hottest hitter for the Longhorns the last 10 games. You're still going to play for the double play at home with the next hitter.
Yeah. I think you go breaking ball. They go fastball, and that ball's fair. Down the right field line, this is going to drive in a couple. Zubia on the way to second. Two-run double, and Texas with a 3-1 lead.
Fastballs right down the middle. Zach just stayed with it. You see him point at it. That's a fair ball. First base umpire agrees. Very huge double, two RBIs. Texas takes a two-run lead, 3-1 here in the eighth.
Take advantage, leadoff triple, walk, stolen base, double. Texas with a three spot. That's the 10th hit of the night of the Texas hitters. Still nobody out in the frame here in the bottom of the eighth. Sanders set. Now he steps off. Time call. As he goes out.
Two right-handers throwing.
To make a move on the mound. So he comes out. He's going to go to the bullpen here. There is serious conversation. Give you the new pitcher when we come back. There's a serious conversation on the mound right there. South Carolina goes to the bullpen again, and Parker Coyne comes into the game. 6'2", 210 pound. Two-year letterman, senior from Swanee, Georgia. He comes on here, and Zeke, you just... you were just saying in the break to me, we'll give you the numbers on Parker momentarily, but how big was the two? It was huge because when you go to the ninth for South Carolina, they had Wes Clark leading off, and he was one swing of the bat and giving them the lead.
Yeah, with a two-run lead at the moment. If he does happen to get a hold of one, that one solo won't beat you. But Parker Coyne making his second appearance for South Carolina, just one inning. Nobody out here in the eighth.
It's one run, three hits, no miscues, South Carolina, 3-10-0 for Texas. This inning started here in the bottom of the eighth. Eric Kennedy in the first pitch. He saw the ball down the right field line and hit the padding against the fencing and sort of kicked back toward the infield. That led to a leadoff triple. Antico walked, stole second. And then ahead in the count, Zach Zubia takes a ball away from him right down the right field line. Two-run double separated the game. That's where we stand right here. 3-1, still nobody out. Bottom of the eighth for Texas as Ardwine strides to the plate. He is 0 for 3 as he comes to the plate. He'd love to play, get him over, get him in here for if you're Texas. Breaking ball, swing and a miss. Nice job by Burgess to keep that ball in front.
It's called having your mind made up. You're swinging.
He was swinging. Breaking ball again. Great job by Burgess. Keep that ball from getting through the screen. That wasn't even close.
It wasn't. You just throw the glove out there, backhand it. Find it. Zubia at second base, not going anywhere with no outs. Got to go to the screen.
Ardwine steps back in. South Carolina pinched in the outfield, really giving the lines in both sides, left and right. Breaking ball outside. And it's 2-1. You can see him really pinched to the middle of the field. Take away the gaps.
Seitler out there on left is really exaggerated.
Hard one steps back in. Zubia from second. Fastball misses way outside. And it's 3-1.
Do you ever think as a hitter that with him being so far over in left center that they're not going to throw me in?
Oh, I'd absolutely be looking for something away.
Yeah.
Because why are they going to play there if they're not going to pitch me out there?
That's way over.
Points 3-1 in there for a strike. And the count goes full. Steps back in. The payoff. Downstairs, ball four. Four batters for Texas here. Bottom of the eighth, all four have reached. And all Texas batters tonight have reached base safely. Valtini will step in. He's had a big night. Doubled and scored, singled, and struck out. Had been outstanding defensively for Texas.
The two plays back to back, one to his right, one to his left. save two base runners. They were just outstanding plays.
Squares to punt. Back out in front. Only play is to first. They get an out. Great execution there. Sacrifice goes 1-3. So everybody moves up 90 feet. Now the infield will have to be drawn up, and we're going to have a pinch hitter. Dalton Porter will pinch hit. True freshman, 6 foot, 190 pounder from Roush High School here in the Austin area. It's a matchup situation. David Pierce is looking at going, you know, just I like the matchup of the righty versus lefty with the infield drawn up. So Porter steps in. Another trip to the mound. And I think they're going to do a matchup situation. We're going to have another pitching change here. So on the backside of that, does Texas counter themselves? Well, I'm not sure. He went out, pointed to the bullpen. And now he comes back across the mound again.
I think they're going to the wristband, maybe for the signs right here. A lot of teams have started using that, like David Pierce uses it with the hitters. Put the wristband on because Sanders couldn't see the signs earlier.
Yeah.
Maybe they're going to go to that.
Well, still, you see it from the side. You can give that signal. But what we've seen here in the eighth inning is you get to the bullpen. It's been a strength for South Carolina so far this season. Texas has started taking advantage of it here in the eighth inning.
Well, both the starting pitchers did really well getting out of jams early in the ball game. Only two runs until this eighth inning where Texas has put up a couple, but the bullpen for South Carolina, three guys have come in with no walks and they've left the game with walks, and that's hurt them this inning as a little command.
Yeah, Eric Kennedy started the inning. You know, this is the first of three. We're excited to have all of them for you over the weekend. And, you know, looking forward to tomorrow. And when you look to tomorrow, you look at 2:30 instead of 6:30, but you know what, our TIFF's treat, warm cookie moment at this point, the play of the game brought to you by TIFF Treats. It's no question is that base hit by Zach Zubia.
This right here, fastball down the middle and low. Zach did a great job keeping the ball inside the bag. Big man's fired up out there. I know he didn't go get cookies for a long time in the grocery store, but he's liking that warm cookie moment right there.
Big move last year to lose some weight, take care of his body, and boy, it's paid off. Now, right now, hitting .349 on the year. Game-winning RBIs if the Texas can hold on to this one. As it'll be a new pitcher, a left-hander comes into the game.
John Gilbreth making his second appearance. Senior out of Rock Hill, South Carolina. Two and a third. Couple strikeouts, three walks for the left-hander. Got a win earlier this season. That's Winthrop. Hitting in a third out of the bullpen. Two walks, two strikeouts. Right now, got his hands full of the runners on second and third. One out here in the eighth.
You know, DJ is out taking some swings. And Porter had been announced, so they go to make the move to the left-hander. David Pierce makes the other move as he brings on Trinsky to hit. Great opportunity for the senior, Magnolia. Get some separation. Infield has to come up here. Cut the runoff at the plate. downstairs. Actually called a strike.
Backdoor breaking ball, first pitch. Wise move with a couple runners on coming out of the bullpen. DJ lays off of it, but it's called a strike.
Left-hander comes set. Fastball way up and away. Count evens at 1-1. These are two veterans.
It's a matchup thing. Righty comes in. You want to pinch hit the lefty? Well, they're going to go to the lefty. I'm going to pinch hit a righty. Back to back pinch hitters for the same hitter.
Speed upstairs. In the big leagues, you get a game played because you've been announced.
Yes. Incentives.
Absolutely. 2-1 to DJ as he steps back in.
Also in the big leagues, you have to face three hitters coming out of the bullpen.
Nowadays.
Unless it ends an inning.
Big swing comes up empty. Not the way it used to be. Got to make contact now. You're on the other side. You're looking for the strikeout. Two, two. Out to center. It's going to fall in for a base hit. DJ drives in the fourth run of the ball game. He stays with it, lines it into center.
You gotta like that for DJ and for the Horns. Again, down and away off the plate. DJ stays with it. Drops it right in front of Brady Allen out there. And he thought about it for a second, but let it drop. Another big RBI run scored right there for Texas.
Third of the inning, fourth of the ball game. And that brings the switch hitter Cam Williams to the plate. Williams 1-for-3 in this one. Singled back in the seventh from the left side. Now is a right-handed hitter. Chopped on the ground. Second for one. The relay to first in time. 5-4-3 double play ends the inning, but not before damage done by Texas as they come up with a three spot. We go to the ninth. Texas 4-1. The nation's leading home run hitter with 8. He is 1-for-3 tonight. And this is the way you want to face him, leading off an inning with a 3-run lead as we go to the ninth. See, not at the very top across college baseball. 3-4-5 due for South Carolina to face Aaron Nixon. Now for his second inning of work, he's been staked to a 3-run lead. First pitch in there for a strike to the DH from South Carolina.
3, 4, and 5 hitters have the 3 hits, all singles for South Carolina.
The 0-1 on the ground. Daly has it, spins, throws to first. Couldn't be picked. They made a turn. They're going to get him. He made the turn to the inside after the ball got through. Great job by Silas Ardwan to recognize it.
You always got to be somewhere on the ball field. This play wasn't easy for Mitchell Daly. Playing up the middle, has to go to his left and turn. Made a good one-hop throw. Zach just couldn't come up with it, but Clark made the turn. Silas was right there and made the throw back.
Watch him turn to the inside right there. You make that commitment.
He was trying to sell it that he was safe, but that's He got him on the arm before the arm got to the bag. Heads up play by Silas Ardoin right there.
They're going to review it, but there's no question of being in the right spot. And this video will show him making that move towards second base as they will come together. They can discuss it here before they go take a view, but I don't think there's any doubt that he turns to the inside.
No, he turned. I think
that doubt doesn't show it. Yeah.
And he did tag him. Been plenty of time before he got to the base.
So they're having a conversation here, but a great job. That's a great view of it. You can see him turn to the inside. And Now, did he get a tag on him? Is the other story. And they're looking to say he may not have made a tag, but he was definitely a base runner on the way to second.
Well, he wouldn't have dove back into first like he did if he didn't think he committed to second. But a heads-up play on all parts. Good play by Daly getting to the ball. And good play by Silas Ardoin to back it up. Take a look. Silas gets rid of it quick. I think he missed him initially, Zonk, but I think he came back and got him in the helmet.
Hit him in the helmet.
Before the hand was on the base.
Chance to see it again right here. He wasn't on the base. He definitely touched his helmet before the left hand got to the bag.
That's what I got out of that.
Me too, and I would think this stands up, and it's out number one. Still taking a review on it, but felt like Clark definitely turned to the inside. Clark remains at first base, hoping that he's going to be a base runner. And here comes the call. He is out for the first out of the inning. Made that commitment. They're going to give him a base hit on the play, and then the putout goes 2-3.
4-2-3.
4-2-3. You gotta like that.
Fourth hit of the night.
Second for Clark.
Heads up on all ends by Texas right there.
Be in the right spot. Seidler steps in.
And would have had a leadoff batter on in the ninth.
Nixon just pours it in there for strike one. Freshman from McCallum.
Not too far from here, is it?
McCallum, Texas?
Oh, I thought you said McCallum High School.
No.
McCallum, Texas, yes.
It's a fur piece.
Yes, it is.
We're not going to get there by daylight. One of those things. The 1-1 on the ground. Zubia for the sixth time in the ball game, three unassisted, and there's two outs in the ninth.
A lot of ground ball outs for Texas defense today. Zach's played some really good first base, almost where his ball went for the double and two RBIs. He's playing back, goes down to a knee, takes it himself.
That's the sixth, three unassisted on the night. So two gone for Nixon. Longhorn fans come to their feet. Game one of this three-game set. Texas an out away from securing the victory in the first one. Fastball in there for a strike. Eisler. Good breaking ball, and quickly it's 0-2.
That's tight. Sharp, late bite on that breaking ball. A lot of determination right there.
Outside corner, strike three call. Aaron Nixon gets his first career victory, and the Longhorns win game one of this three-game set.
Well, it was about all we wanted in this ball game. It was a pitcher's duel all the way to the end with the called strike three by Aaron Nixon. couple of good innings for that young man. He's fired up. Texas is very happy to get this first game, the first loss of the season for South Carolina. They're now 11-1. Texas gets the win, stayed with it, got the bullpen involved for South Carolina, and got the big leadoff triple by Eric Kennedy, and then just added a few more. A big double by Zach Zubia to score a couple runs. So the eighth inning, huge for Texas, and a big win against a big-time opponent.
Final score here from UFCU Dishfuck Field, Texas 4, South Carolina 1. We come back, we'll talk to Zach Zubia on the field. 4-1 Texas victory. We come back, Zach Zubia. He has been outstanding so far this season. Comes up with a giant hit as he goes the other way in the bottom of the eighth inning. Texas finds a way to put a two spot on the board. Zubia later on in the inning comes around to score, and Texas comes away with a 4-1 victory. A couple of things, Greg Swindell, Keith Moreland, glad you're with us. A couple of things that jump off the board for me today. Both these starting pitchers pitched really well. Thomas Farr had a career high strikeouts. He kept South Carolina in the game. On the other side, Ty Madden didn't have as good a stuff as we've seen the last two times out, but he found a way to take the stuff he had and made himself competitive against one of the best offensive teams in America.
Right. South Carolina is a very good offensive team, and Ty Madden, some nights you're going to have to do that. And tonight he had to reach back, find a little more when you're not on top of your game. Great pitchers do that. Ty Madden was able to keep his team in the game until the eighth inning when they were able to get the three runs. So hat off to him, and hat off to Zubia, who's the last 10 games has been one of the best hitters in the country.
Well, he's done an outstanding job, has Zach, and then the other part is Aaron Nixon comes in to close the door. It's good to see him get back out there after what happened to him down in Houston. We're going to take this opportunity. We think we have Zach down on the field. And congratulations, Zach, Keith, and Greg upstairs. Talk to us about, you know, this environment, this game, what y'all been looking forward to the Friday night against South Carolina.
I mean, this is an incredible crowd. I mean, best fans in the country, hands down. I mean, can you blame them? It was loud, you know, great opponent in the dish today, and it was just a fun game overall.
Zach, take us through that last at-bat there in the eighth inning. Had a fielder's choice and then a couple strikeouts and had a two. I didn't think they would throw to you in that situation because you have been hot. Take us through that at-bat.
Yeah, I mean, you just got to slow the game down. Just got to calm down, control that breathing, and just get a pitch to hit. And luckily, I didn't put a good swing on it. I mean, got to use the whole field. So
you did it right there, huh?
Well, I mean, you use the whole field, but that's something you've done most of your career. You know, the other thing I want to talk to you about, do you realize you had six unassisted plays at first base tonight? Did you know you had that many ground balls?
I mean, they kept on hitting backside ground balls, and I mean, they just got to keep you on your toes every single time. So yeah, I mean, they're a good hitting team, they're a good pitching team, and I mean, we just got the best of it today, and we got to come back ready to play tomorrow.
Big triple by Eric to lead off that eighth. He's now tied for the team lead in triples with you.
I mean, I think we know who's a little faster. I mean, I think it's me. But
now, one of the things, you've been around, you're a veteran guy, and you're one of the leaders of this ball club now. What would y'all try? Y'all getting together after each win, you can see that. What are y'all talking about unity, or trying to figure out how y'all are doing?
I mean, we're just going to keep on talking about how we're going to come back the next day, every single day, with the same attitude and same focus.
Well, thanks for taking the time, and good luck to you for the rest of the weekend. Congratulations on the big hit tonight, Zach.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
I'm telling you, when you look at it, we have had an unbelievable ball game tonight. Well, this is the first of three. Texas finds a way to win this. There is a schedule change, Greg, for all of you out there. It says 6 o'clock, then it was moved to 6:30. It's now 2:30 tomorrow afternoon, and then the final game, after you put your clock forward on Saturday night, it's an 11 a.m. start. We'll have all the games for you right here on LHN. Final score here, as Texas wins it 4-1. For Greg Swindell, and I'm Keith Moreland. Don't forget, we're back tomorrow at 2:30. Coming up next on LHN, Texas Southern versus Tarleton State softball. See you tomorrow, folks.